The universe is in some ways comfortably familiar. We have a sun, and it's one of a class of stars, all bearing similar characteristics. And we know how they work so well that we can predict its phases of life, and the coming red giant phase in the far future, and then retirement as a white dwarf, and finally a stage that no one in the universe has yet seen, a permanent cinder phase, a black dwarf with no residual heat left over. The reason no one has seen this yet is because the universe just isn't old enough for its white dwarf stellar remnants to have dissipated their residual heat. Thus, they are still glowing coals, standing as testaments to the stars they once were. So will be the fate of the sun. But that we have never seen a black dwarf, we can only predict it, illustrates that there are things possible in this universe that are not currently possible. This works for the future of stars with black dwarf cinders, but it also works for the past. There were things that were once possible in the universe that no longer are, because the conditions of the early universe were so radically different from what we have today. One such extinct object is known as a quasi-star, and it is a strange idea indeed. It works like this. Very early in the history of the universe, when the very first stars were forming, it's possible that a protostar, which is a very young star still accreting material from around it, gained sufficient mass to collapse in on itself and become a black hole. Before that, such a protostar would not have lived long, only 7 to 10 million years before the mass compelled the implosion. But that also means that there would still have been material around it that was accreting in its continued formation, including the outer layers of the forming star itself, which may have been able to absorb the shock of the formation of the black hole without being blown away, as what would happen in a modern supernova. There is also the question of dark matter lurking here. The universe was much more compact during this period, with a lot of gravity at play. And since dark matter exerts gravity, we can see it doing that, then that also may have played into the formation of quasi-stars. Another attribute of this time is that the universe was only hydrogen and helium, and a tiny bit of lithium, with no other contamination by heavier elements, something that was yet to happen because those elements are created by stars, not big bangs, and there had not yet been enough time for their formation. This gets into the mysterious question of population 3 stars, which quasi-stars may have been examples of. We no longer have any of these stars today, they are long dead, having gone supernova and filled the universe with heavier elements. But when we look into space deeply, as the James Webb Space Telescope does, it also looks back in time, and there is hope that Webb can look so distantly as to glimpse a population 3 star. But if the protostars that may have formed quasi-stars were very massive population 3 stars, they didn't stay that way and collapsed into black holes due to extreme mass. This would have left the strange situation of a black hole replacing the core of a star, with the outer layers remaining intact. That would have had the effect of completely replacing nuclear fusion as the mechanism by which the star was operating. It would still look like a star, but there would be no fusion present. Rather, the radiant energy that would come from infalling material from the star's layers and the surrounding nebula. Strangely, that radiant energy flowing out would do what a normal star does. It would counteract gravity and create an equilibrium state for the star. And it's a lot of energy. This kind of star, across its short lifetime, would have been as luminous as the total energy output of a small galaxy. And the death of one would be even stranger. As a quasi-star aged, it would cool over time, becoming transparent in its outer envelope, revealing the black hole inside until it cooled to the point that no equilibrium was possible, and the object would dissipate, with the exception of the black hole, which would be an intermediate mass black hole that would act like a normal black hole accreting material that got close to it. This all may seem hypothetical and academic, but in fact it actually solves an astrophysical problem. We don't really know how the supermassive black holes that lay at the centers of most galaxies came to be. There are a lot of things like their mass and age that seem off, but if they started as quasi-stars, that may shed light on their history, because they would have formed under abnormal circumstances that no longer exist in the universe today. What isn't clear is how dark matter plays into all of this. predicting what kinds of stars once existed but no longer do, and what once will exist when the universe is old enough, and how they behave, always suffers from a wild card, which is dark matter and how it behaves. An example here are neutron stars. You would normally think of a neutron star as a dead star. It just happened to be massive enough to become a neutron star instead of a white dwarf. It's always been believed that neutron stars cool over time, and they do. But because of dark matter, there may be something else going on that we weren't previously aware of. Neutron stars are insanely dense, which means a lot of gravity in a small package. Dark matter doesn't seem to interact in any other way except gravity, however. Well, what does high gravity in a very dense environment do? Forces particles together. This should work for dark matter as well, meaning that a neutron star could act as a trap for dark matter particles. Get dark matter particles, if that's what that phenomenon is, traveling really fast in a gravitationally strong environment, and crash them together, and they may annihilate with each other. And the end result could be heat. The key question here, though, is does dark matter interact with itself? And that is unknown. So dark matter, if it is a particle, needs to be electrically neutral, or else it would interact electromagnetically. That may mean that it works like normal matter. Whatever particles make up dark matter and make it neutral could have antiparticles, and that might allow for dark matter annihilation in a similar way to how matter and antimatter annihilate. Neutron stars might be the best environment for these particles to meet, and if dark matter is its own antiparticle, which is a widespread assumption in physics, then the release of energy inside a neutron star could sustain it as a heat-producing object and weird kind of analog of a normal star. In other words, neutron stars may not be running on fusion, but instead anti-dark matter. This is an interesting proposition because while we really understand very little about dark matter, we do know a fair amount about neutron stars, and we can readily study them, which means they may be acting as dark matter laboratories that we can comfortably study from a distance and glean information about dark matter. Dark matter annihilation in most models would have been common in the early universe. Things were much more dense, like our quasi-stars. But as the universe aged, the interaction became far more rare. But if you get a lot of dark matter in one place, like the interior of a neutron star, it could still be happening. And it has to be said that when searching for dark matter in the particle accelerator and the like, scientists are looking and hoping for a rare interaction between a particle of dark matter and an atomic nucleus. That's an interaction with protons and neutrons. Well, if that happens, which we've never seen it, then you can expect that interaction to happen in neutron stars. They are called neutron stars for a reason, making them perfect dark matter detectors. The catch here is that the neutron star needs to be old and cooled to the point that the signal of the annihilation heat wouldn't get drowned out by the residual heat bleeding off from when the neutron star was a regular star. JWST, however, is suited for this, and there's more. It's also possible that white dwarfs might also be able to concentrate dark matter like this. And that's particularly interesting, because if it does happen in that context, then white dwarfs may never completely cool into black dwarfs as long as there is dark matter around to accumulate. They'll shut that down by exhausting it, and that reaction would stop, and the black dwarf would still eventually result. That may be the case for most white dwarfs. They run out of dark matter at a similar rate that they run out of heat, but that's something that could be studied through observation. There may be other ways to detect dark matter and try to figure out its nature. Another option are primordial black holes, which may have formed very early in the history of the universe. Again, something that once may have been able to form, but today may no longer be able to. Some of these may have been extremely small indeed, smaller than atoms in some models, but they still would be black holes. Remember, a black hole the mass of Earth is not much larger than a marble. Get enough of these tiny black holes still existing, and they become a candidate for dark matter. And the place to look for evidence of them is the moon. The idea is this. If those black holes are plentiful enough to account for dark matter, then the bodies of the solar system should have been bombarded by them, and the moon may preserve evidence of this. Interestingly, like dark matter, black holes do not interact with light. Essentially, what would need to be searched for are craters, small ones, just a few meters across, that have different shapes and geologic properties than normal craters formed by asteroid strikes. It's basically the difference between punching through something as opposed to impacting it. Since these objects would be passing through the moon, there should be a corresponding exit wound. But that's a lot of ifs. Microscopic, primordial black holes need to have a mechanism to have formed, and there has been very little work done on the required tiny fluctuations that would need to have been present in the early universe for it. Then they need to still be here without having evaporated, and then they need to hit the moon. At least, however, if these craters are never found, in science a null result is still useful because it works like a process of elimination. One more idea will have left the table, until there are only a few possibilities left, which makes resolving them easier because it's clearer what to look for. And if it turns out that dark matter is something like normal matter, with structure, atoms, and a general mirror to our universe, then what happens when dark matter collapses to form a black hole? Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the moon's well-being if it spent its entire existence getting shot through with micro black holes left over from the primordial universe. Nothing about that seems good. Hope it's okay. Be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.